Well, we're going to hear a bit of Lucretia, both from male chorus and from Lucretia herself later on. And we're going to start with the Ride to Rome, where the male chorus, his character is sort of, I see the male chorus and the female chorus as very much related to the ancient Greek orators, narrators, who not only were telling the story, but they were part of the aesthetic and the ethos and the ethics of this time. And oops, and I found something interesting. Britten's Lucretia embraces the old Greek ideas of the artist as ethical and aesthetic interpreter of life. They held the belief that the psychological effect of art, especially music, could profoundly influence the constitution of the state. Now, if only. and that going back to, because I'm singing some Britten Purcell songs coming up, and I'm always interested to hear, and I do hear, in all this recitative in Lucretia, Purcell, quite clearly. And I feel that his influence, I wrote these down earlier, his clarity, his strangeness, tenderness, and attack, astonishing range and variety of subtlety and colour from small forces, as in, you know, Dido and a lot of these, whatever you would call them, scenes that Purcell set, not necessarily operas. And also from the fact that you've only got 12 instruments here and 8 protagonists. So it's setting up the same sort of intimacy and responsibility of ensemble with everybody, and including your character, who I think is the person who holds it all together. God, I'll take this off. Why am I going? Terrible. Holds it all together, and interestingly, as you were saying earlier, you identify, and it's kind of expected today, you identify not just with Tarquinius, but with others too, yes. And that they identify with you. I thought that's interesting osmosis effect, is that it's not just the male chorus is reading Tarquinius's mind, but maybe you're steering Tarquinius too. Because you say things, who's to say what comes first? You are his conscience, his whole understanding. You understand more. You're all-seeing character. Anyway, I'll stop telling you. You just do your thing. So I thought that was interesting. So you're going to start at the point when...
So it's just at the point where Julius has planted the seed in Tarquinius' mind that, well, she's a... You can have everything, you're a prince, but you can't have her, can you? She's really chaste. And anyway, good night.
Yes.
Because his wife, of course, hasn't been chaste. And everyone's... He's had the mick taken out of him. And... Latinus is obviously mightier than now, holier than now, has gone to bed. And Julius has just left this little seed in Tarquinius' mind. Mm. The last thing on the page before I sing is, good night, Tarquinius. And it's this sort of thing in his mind where he's going, oh.
There is no good night. It's
exactly.
Only tomorrow morning. Yes.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah. If you're too hot, anyone do take jackets off. It's up to you. I'm not saying you have to. So... We're starting from there, yes.
Thank you.
stop you there. That's beautiful. Really lovely, you've set that up. I would suggest you sing the last Lucretia, almost like you smell her.
Mm.
And then you might want to close your eyes and take it in to yourself to do something different. You don't have to do that, but it's just none of these things you have to do. It's just a suggestion that she's become, you know, part of you are. You will probably have Tarquinius very close to you at this point. I liked so much of that. I really liked the way you kept your eyes still. And that I would suggest, when you've got a new thought, if you think that thought quite early, and then when the eye, when the words come, it comes out of that thought. Don't have the thought and sing. Have the thought and then, it is not far to Rome. So that you're telling us what you're thinking as it happens, rather than, it is not far to Rome. So it fills the bar. So what are you doing? You just said, Lucretia's my empire. I wonder, it is not far to Rome, rather than, it is not far to Rome. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
So fill the bar, preceding bar, with the thought. And we talked earlier about male chorus possibly lying to the audience, because everybody knows the story for this. It's in the title. You know what's going to happen. So maybe, oh, go to bed, Tarquinius. We talked about whether he means that, or do you want him to go to Lucretia's house? Does the male chorus, provoking? Are you prodding him to go? Oh, and then you suddenly have a moment where you're coming out of character. Oh, don't go. But you could be like, oh, don't go, do go. So maybe turn away from the audience there. Oh, go to bed. Or when you're telling somebody a lie, you don't look at them in the eye, usually, unless you're a very good liar. but if you're a bad liar, you don't look people in the eye. So maybe don't look at the audience. Oh, go to bed. But it would be more interesting if you didn't. You know, so maybe just turn away for that one.
Yeah.
And always let the words come out of a thought that you've already been thinking. So, and you've got lots of time off between thoughts. So use those empty bars to mull over what you're about to say. Let it just come out of what you're saying. Not far. And again, the not far to Rome. Don't begin with the lascivious thought. It's not far to Rome, not far, not far, not far. So that it builds.
Yeah.
Don't go, it's not far to Rome, you know. Got it? So you just start, it's not far to Rome. Not far, not far at all.
Mm-hmm.
It's more interesting to build a thought than to labor it.
Yes, yeah.
But it was a great idea to do that, but just cool it. Until you have the moment. How about going from the excellent, but I am the... I loved your change of character there. It was brilliant. But I am the Prince of Rome. I can do what I like.
Mm-hmm.
And Lucretia's in my sights, as it were, because you already are the empire. She's in my sights. I will have her. And it's not far to Rome. Okay? Play it cool.
Yeah.
But I am the Prince of Rome, and Lucretia's eyes, my empire.
Much more powerful.
Yeah.
Well, you might want to consider not going with the music at all. You know, in this moment, and Lucretia's eyes, my empire, and you've got all this music, which is slightly binding. You sort of feel one needs to be still. But if you're introducing a new thought, you could, like, go... which is not far to Rome. You know, break it up a bit. Mm. I mean, if you want, even though we're in a situation, in a, mm. if you were to do this in an audition, you might want to do... It is not far to Rome. You know, it's important in recital and auditions that we give ourselves a large circle within which we can perform. Mm. Don't feel stuck.
Yeah.
Especially if the music is like this, intense. Mm. Do give yourself a circle. People who come to see me sing leader know that I do move around. I do this and I that and that or whatever. Be natural. And if you have that, what you just did there, that's great too.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, that, it's not far to Rome. But only if it's natural. Don't be... Because, you know, now I've told you, you're going to do it. But, you know, if you're just sort of thinking something, it's not far to Rome. You know, just something so you don't get stuck in this heavy music.
Yeah.
I'm not suggesting you do it there. You can do it anywhere. But don't feel stuck. Try not to feel stuck. How about going from after It's Just Not Far, we've done that. That was great. Okay. Tell us about the lie you're going to tell.
Okay.
Go to bed. Indicate you know that.
Yeah.
Let the audience decide from your words what that means. You don't need to feed the audience every single thought. He's asleep, she's got no defense, no chance. Let the audience decide what that means.
Mm-hmm.
You're just giving them the information here. The city sleeps, Calatin sleeps, Lucretia. So just give them the information, let Britain hasn't given you any indication to do anything there. So you can take it all in. It's all going to go down very badly very soon. Mm. So you're just setting the scene.
Okay.
Do as little as possible. It sounds so beautiful what you're doing. Keep it simple and give us the information. Let's just go from the lights.
The lights of Rome are burning.
Keep the tension.
The city sleeps.
It's great. I would suggest you give a bit more the first time.
Uh-huh.
A bit more danger in the voice, a bit more, I don't know, something a bit more edgy. It's all within legato, but I think you can afford to... They've got tenutas on each note.
Yeah.
So don't make it too bel canto. It's a little bit more urgent. The second one, you can do what you like. But the first one, I think, should have a bit more through gritted teeth.
Mm-hmm.
Now. Isha. Quaver.
Yeah, yeah.
It makes it more edgy. Mm-hmm. Not sure. Isha. Stop dead.
Lucretia.
Yeah.
Lucretia. How can your stars not wait for his servants to wait, or his groom to settle? His net is a bridle, and pushing the eyelids through the beast's bare white teeth, runs him out of the stable, mounts the curb or saddle, the stallion shorts him back. And with fear and with knees, takes his tongue, flicks his whip, throws the brute into mad gallop, impetuous the proud flank, and reckless the rider. Now the prince and Arab seat bend as one, for thus meet. Hear the woods punish the earth, master strain of tendons taught, tail and iron head thrust back, most compact, nothing slack, see the horse takes the beat between his teeth. Now the rein can impede or stop him, yet the prince still whips him. Now ride who's ridden, Tarquinius the stallion, or the beast Tarquinius, in both blood furious, with desire impetuous, burns for its quietus. Speed of flame, through sweat and dust, the arrow flies straight as lust, flies straight as lust. But here they cannot cross. Turn back, Tarquinius. Try to swim this river. Stallion rears, hooks pour stars. The prince desires, so he dares. Now stallion and rider, wake the sea.
He writes so well for tenor. My goodness me. Wonder why. That was really superb, and your fronts of the words were really strong this time. They're such quick learners, these guys. I just mentioned it once this morning or earlier today, and you absolutely got it. I was just pointing out that when I was at ENO, Tony Legg, the head of music, used to sit in the auditorium in rehearsals and yell out from the back row, "Can't hear you! What?" And he always used to say it's the front of the word is more important than the final consonant, because then we have a fighting chance of knowing what the word is if we know how it begins, but with no idea by if we're just doing the last consonant, because the word's gone. So I thought that was so much better. So there's massive tongue twisters in this as well. muscles strained, tendons taut, tall head held high, head thrust back. All's come back. I love the way you said nothing slack. See the horse takes a bit between its teeth and whips him. That was all great. Impetuous. Quite a thing to learn, isn't it?
Oh,
rhythmically, yeah. And kind of cross, turn back. Tarquins. Now that's when we decided you would look away. But so given that I didn't hear you do it earlier, I think maybe that one you wouldn't turn away. It felt wrong. Maybe the first time you sang it.
Yeah.
But not that time. I think you can do a bald-faced lie to everyone and just say, brazen it out, front of one. Turn back, Tarquinius, don't. It's too exciting. So I think just wowing it out there for that one.
Yeah.
You can look a little concerned, but I think ultimately you are with him on that horse and we're with you. That's the only way we know what's happening is through you. Your B flat's fabulous. Now, my only concern is right at the beginning, Tarquinius does not dare. We talked earlier about recitative being too quiet. And while I'm not asking to give more, he says senza voce, which means more consonants to me. So I would say it's almost a stage whisper, but operatic stage whispers have to be a little bit more because we have, unlike play stage whispers, because they've got something underneath, even though it's very quiet. So menacingly, Tarquinius does not dare. Can you give me more of that flavour?
Yeah, yeah.
Would you mind just giving... Sorry, did you have a question?
Is it later on in the piece, there's a similar sort of... I mean, it's marked slightly differently, but this is a panther agile.
Yes.
Panther,
yes,
sort of.
Yes, very much so. If it says senza voce, I'll have to find that bit. Will you find that bit for me? Or is that the oatmeal slippers of sleep moment? It's always my favourite line. It depends on the register.
Here it is. The pity is that sin has so much grace. It moves like virtue.
That's it.
Back!
Yep. Back! That's the Peter Pierce. Back, Tarquinius.
Yes.
Back, Tarquinius. But I think, yeah. And that's got crosses through the notes. So that's that's most definitely parlando. But this, he hasn't given crosses, but he says senza voce. So swing it so that we, right at the back of the Colosseum, in the gods, actually it's quite good acoustic up there. I would say the worst acoustic is in the dress circle at the back, under the hood. That's when you need to think about making sure they hear it.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about being multi-dramatic, you know, just really make it hear, make it understood.
Okay. Okay. Can we play around and have a few sort of...
Go for it. How about just two bars before, please, Nadia? He says più forte, having gone from pianissimo, which is crescendo, to probably piano. So I think there's been more of a shock element there. When you get a bit more... But the first statement I thought was brilliant. Tarquinius. I'm sorry.
It's some place before. Thank you.
Thank you. I just wanted to make you aware that they were two different thoughts.
Yes.
There's a semicolon after desire, implying that, but I am the prince of Rome. So if he doesn't desire it, he doesn't get. He's not interested. It's only if he desires it. I think David McVicar said famously, "He'll either kill it, or, excuse me, screw it." But that's how he is. That's how Tarquinius is.
Yeah.
He said a worse word than screw, but we were not going to do that here. But that is very much the nature of this particular Tarquinius. So I think to have a duality going on there, both are completely awful and brutal with the same result at the end. He kills everything.
Yes.
Trust amongst his fellow men. Junius, is, I think, is a really unpleasant character, so I think it's interesting that they've got the two brutes, really. And Collatinus is seen as the uncle who doesn't understand either of them. But he's been there to keep the peace. And my question was, why doesn't Collatinus go home and see his wife? He never does. And he hasn't been for years to see her, so as far as we know. What's going on there, you know? Mm-hmm. So Tarquinius has definitely seen her far more than Collatinus has, which is interesting. So, is there anything else you would like to ask me?
No, I think we've covered it, really.
Well, I thought a lot of it's absolutely brilliant from you. I'm just trying to think. You've got the front of the words, you've got the meaning, everything's brilliant. I look forward to hearing you do this in real life. I shall come and see you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.